Hey there, so today I'm going to be reviewing this, which is a second generation Kessler low C bass clarinet. I ran into Dave Kessler this past spring in Las Vegas, and I asked him if he'd be willing to lend me an instrument to review on this series, and he said sure, but he was finishing the final touches on a second generation model. He only had the first generation in stock, so he said wait, I waited, he sent me this, and here we go. He also told me a couple of the differences between the first generation, if you're familiar with it, and the second generation. The first generation was made of hard rubber. Second generation is a lighter weight synthetic that has different resonance qualities. The keywork is a little bit different. I guess there are a few other changes. I never saw the first generation, so I'm only going from my memory, which isn't great. The other thing that Dave Kessler does is that when you order from Kessler, you have an option to upgrade the case to a BAM trekking case, and if you're interested, you can go watch my video reviews of cases. And you also have an option to change the mouthpiece if you want a, you know, a Rico or a Van Doren or a Selmer mouthpiece. He's willing to swap that in for an additional charge. But what you then get is you get a case and a mouthpiece that you want, rather than one that you're going to have to kind of put in the basement or try and sell on eBay. You'll get the thing that you want. But here we have the stock bass clarinet case. And let's open it up and give it a look. All right, so the case itself is actually not a hard, I mean, it's hard underneath, but it's covered in a fabric, which is unique to student model bass clarinets. I've never actually seen it this way. It has a music pouch in the front that you can put your music in, which is really cool. And it is a, it has a handle on the top and a handle on the side, or maybe that's the top and that's the side. Doesn't really matter. All right. Oh my. So now that that's done, it is a two-piece bass clarinet because it's low C. It's going to come apart in the middle. It comes with a peg. I don't think he sent me a mouthpiece because he knows that I have one. It is a two-part neck which tunes in the middle here. So very similar. It's a French neck style. And then, you know, he's got a swab and cork grease and that sort of thing. So let's put it together and give it a tune. All right, so the first thing that I noticed was that it wouldn't play because there were shims, little cork shims inside of some of the low notes here just to keep the keys closed during transit. So again, if you are getting a new instrument and it feels really weird and it's not playing at all the way you're expecting it to, first would you check to see if there are cork shims inside of it. You would generally find them keeping keys closed, but just give it a once over to see if there's any cork that looks out of place. Just slide those out. Okay, so once I actually put my hands on the instrument after I pulled all the corks out, was I noticed that the keywork was actually really, it felt really good. What it felt like to me is that the alloy used in the metal for the keys was stronger than some of the other student model bass clarinets that I've reviewed, some of which cost more than this instrument. And why it's so important, well, I always say this, the most important thing to think about in a student model bass clarinet is the quality of the keywork. Since we're not talking about wood here, because this is either a plastic or a resin, or not in this case, but it could be hard rubber, that, you know, there's not a lot of consistency changes like there is with wood. So the big difference in a lot of these is the quality of the keywork. Well, it looks here to be that Kessler has put some real thought into it, and he cared about the quality of the keys. So why is it important to have strong alloy and strong keys or good quality keys is that when you're walking with the instrument in the case, or when you're putting it together, or if you jostle it a little bit, or if you're carrying it around, or if you're setting it on your stand, anything that you do, well, you know, the keys are have the potential to be jiggled in a way that makes them go out of adjustment. Now, if the metal is soft, then the keys will go out of adjustment faster. And what does that mean? That means that when you play certain fingering combinations, some pads won't close, or you'll have a leak. Or in some cases, you know, just the whole thing will just not feel like it works. All this means is that you're going to be spending more time in the repair shop than you otherwise would have to. So it's important to have good, strong keys, and this instrument feels like it's got them. Now, there's one thing that I don't especially care for, which is how the low notes are configured here. This is a low C. Looks like a smiley face. This is a low C. This is a C sharp, or D flat, and this is a D. There's also a D key over here, which is nice to have. Oh, and by the way, it's got a left-hand E flat, A flat key, which is great. But what I don't especially like about this, and what's different between this and my instrument, is that the C to the C sharp, mine has a roller in here, and what that means is that it's easier to roll your hand from one to the other if you have to do a chromatic scale quickly. Plus, you know, going from C sharp to D, obviously you can go from C sharp here to D here. It's just, you know, it's just, it's a little bit more clunky, and it's certainly not something that I'm used to. It's not terrible. I mean, it works. You can get used to it. It's just that I'm not used to it. So, enough of me talking. Let me play a chromatic scale from low C. Hell yes. That's nice and full. It's really even, and by that I mean timbre-wise, each note sounds like the note before. There is not a stuffy note in the bunch. Boy, it's really, really even. I don't think I've played a student model bass clarinet that feels this even. There's no stuffy note in this. Wow, let's hear it quietly. Well, what's important to me about that, it keeps the core. So you can hear the core sound of the instrument. It doesn't sort of spread out and get stuffy or get airy. It keeps its core. I'm going to do something I have not done before. I'm going to do a blind listening test for you. I'm going to play a piece of music, a short one, with this instrument, and then with this instrument. Maybe I'll do it in opposite order, who knows? But I want you to see if you can tell the difference between the two instruments. By the way, this is my usual horn. Just sort of make a note of what is different between, I guess, an instrument that costs $18,000 and one that costs $2,000, okay? Here, you know what? Instead of you having to close your eyes, I will close them for you now. Instrument that I played was this one. It was my Selmer Model 67 privilege bass clarinet. And the second I played was the Kessler. Now, playing them side by side, I'm going to feel differences between the two instruments. Of course, any two instruments are going to feel different from one another. The key work on mine, you know, I'm used to it, right? I'm used to where the keys are, I'm used to how they feel, I'm used to how far they go down before they close the pad. Everything's a little different between the two instruments, and that's going to be the case between any two instruments, whether they're the same brand or whether they're different brands of bass clarinet. That is not a factor you should use, because all of that can be adjusted, mostly. The one thing that did feel different, however, was the fact that my bass clarinet, in order to get the sound that I wanted, in order to get the timbre that I wanted, it took a lot less effort. It took a lot less air. It took a lot less, you know, it felt like the instrument wasn't resisting me as much as the Kessler does. Now, that might be a factor of, you know, the differences in the quality of the two instruments, but I did feel that in order to get the sound I wanted out of that Bach etude, I had to push a lot more and I had to work a lot harder to get the Kessler to do what I wanted it to do. That said, it's still pretty darn good. I was able to get the sound I wanted. Some bass clarinets, some student model bass clarinets, no matter how hard I try, I'm not going to get them to sound the way I want them to sound. This one, that was not the case, which is great. So the next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to play this with a tuner like I do with all of the instruments that I'm trying to show you how well it plays in tune with itself. So here we go. This is my tuner. This is what I use for all of these videos. And the way it works again, for those of you who may not remember, is these three, four sets of lines here, they need to stop moving entirely if the instrument is perfectly in tune. I'm gonna spend most of my time worrying about the first three to see that they don't move. If they move up, that means that note is sharp. If they move down, that means they're flat. that's pretty standard, actually. I was watching it as we were playing. I wasn't making adjustments to bring them all in tune, though I could have made all of those notes in tune if I had gotten used to this instrument and I was, you know, I was able to figure out which are where, and I just know where to adjust the back of my tongue or my embouchure or pressure or kind of air that I'm blowing. That will make every note in tune. That's just part of getting to know your instrument better. This is actually pretty well in tune, especially in the middle register. That's pretty good, okay? So when we get to some of the extremes, so it's gonna be sharp, it's gonna be sharp. So I could pull that out, but that would just mean that that middle register would be flat. Just something to be aware of. Not bad, not bad at all. Okay, so what do I think? Well, to go over the things that I care about, the instrument quality, it feels really good. The keys feel good. The way that it sounds is really, really excellent. Compared to, you know, the Ridenour, compared to the RS Berkeley, even compared to the Selmer 1430 or whatever it was that I tried, all of the student bass clarinets that I've tried, this one stands up very well. So definite thumbs up. It sounds good. The key work is good. It's in tune. It came out of the box playing, which is a great thing. If Dave Kessler, if you box up all your bass clarinets this way, good on you. I wish everybody else would do the same. The case, even the standard case that it comes with, is also really, really good. Things that I'm not so keen on, I don't like the low fingering system, but I suppose that's something that I could get used to, the low C, the low C sharp, and the low D. And also, it does take a little bit more work for me to get the sound I'd like out, but that is probably something I could get used to if I adjusted my reeds a little bit and, you know, for this instrument, because my reeds are adjusted for my instrument. But as far as, you know, overall initial quality goes, it is something you definitely should put on your consideration list and give it a try. For those of you who own either the first generation or this generation of Kessler, please put your comments below so that we can all learn from you. But as far as I'm concerned, this is definitely a thumbs up. So again, thanks very much for watching. I hope this was helpful. You're welcome, those of you who wanted me to review this instrument. Thanks for asking. And yeah, we'll see you next time. As always, I hope this was helpful. Bye.